Professor Jung, in our several interesting discussions so far, a great deal of our talk has been some of the very fundamental aspects of your theory, your writing, and of course our main purpose in getting some of your reactions to these fundamental ideas was so that our students, many of whom have not had an opportunity to study a great deal of your work, might sort of be introduced to some of your ideas from you personally, which of course is probably the best way they possibly could be. Now, of course, as one looks over your work, one is impressed with a much broader scope, of course, and just the beginning fundamental outline of a theory of personality.
Well, of course, when you study human psychology, you can't help noticing that man's psychology doesn't only consist of the ramifications of instinct in his behavior. These instincts are not the only determinants. There are many others. And the study of man from his biological aspect only is by far insufficient to understand human psychology. It is absolutely necessary that you study man also in his social and general environments.
Yes.
And so you have to consider, for instance, the fact that there are different kinds of society, different kinds of nations, different traditions, and to that purpose it is absolutely necessary that one treats the problem of the human psyche from many standpoints, and each is a most considerable task, naturally. Thus, when I, after my association experiments, when I realized that there is obviously an unconscious, the question arose, now, what is this unconscious? Does it consist merely of rests, of remnants, of conscious activities, or are there things that are practically forever unconscious? In other words, is the unconscious a factor in itself? And I soon came to the conclusion that the unconscious must be a factor in itself, because I observed time and again that, for instance, people's dreams or schizophrenic patients' delusions and fantasies contain the motives which they couldn't possibly have acquired in our surroundings. This depends upon the fact that the child is not born tabula rasa, but it is a definite mixture of or combination of genes. And the gene, although the genes seem to contain chiefly dynamic factors, arrangeur of a certain behavior, they have a tremendous importance also for the arrangement of the psyche. The psyche too, inasmuch as it appears naturally, before it appears you cannot study it, but inasmuch as it appears, it has certain qualities, it has a certain character, and that needs must depend upon the elements born in the child. So, factors determining human behavior are born with the child and determine its further development. Now that is one side of the picture. The other side of the picture is the individual lives in connection with others in certain definite surroundings that will influence the given combination of qualities. And that is now also a very complicated factor, because the environmental influences are not merely personal. There are any amount of objective factors, the general social conditions, laws, convictions, ways of looking at things, of dealing with things. Now, these things are not of an arbitrary character. They are historical. There are historical reasons why things are they are. And as there are historical reasons for the qualities of the psyche that is born, there is such a thing as the history of man's evolution in the past eons. And that shows that real understanding of the psyche must consist in the elucidation of the history of the human race. History of the mind, for instance, as of the biological, biological data. So, when I wrote my first book concerning the psychology of the unconscious, I already had formed a certain idea of the nature of the unconscious. To me, it was then a living remnant of the original history of man, living in his surroundings. A very complicated picture. And my material then, my empirical material was formed chiefly by lunatics, by cases of schizophrenia. And there I had observed that there are, chiefly in the beginning of a disease, invasions of fantasies into conscious life, fantasies of an entirely unexpected sort, most bewildering to the patient. He gets quite confused by these ideas, and he gets into a sort of panic, because he never before has thought such things, that they are quite strange to him, and equally strange to his physician. Mm-hmm. You see, the agent is equally dumbfounded. Yes. By the peculiar character of those fantasies.
Yes.
And therefore one says that man is crazy.
Yes.
Crazy.
Yes.
To think such things. Nobody.
Yes.
Thinks such.
Yes.
Things.
Yes.
And the patient agrees in a way with him. If he would at least agree, or he does even agree, and all the more he gets into a panic. So, as a alienist, I thought it to be really the task for psychiatry to elucidate that thing that broke into consciousness, these voices, these delusions.
Yes.
In those days, that is, mind you, more than 40 years ago, or almost 50 years ago, I had no hope to be able to treat these cases or to be able to help them, but I had a very great scientific curiosity, and I wanted to know what these things really were, because I thought that these things had a system. They were not merely chaotic, decayed material, because there was too much sense in those fantasies. So what I did then was I studied cases of psychogenic diseases like hysteria, hysteric somnambulism and such things, where the content that came from the unconscious were in a readable condition, in an understandable condition. And then I saw that, in contradistinction to the schizophrenics, the mental contents of hysterics were of a humanly understandable character. They were even elaborate, dramatic, suggestive, insinuating, so one could make out a second personality. Now this is not the case of schizophrenia. There the fantasies, on the contrary, are unsystematic, chaotic, and you cannot make out a proper second personality, apart from rare cases of a complicated nature. Now, I knew of psychopathic cases, just in the balance between schizophrenia and hysteria, where ideas came up, delusions that were not exactly hysterical, because they were singularly difficult to understand. It was a sort of strange eruptions, and I thought that these cases could give me a better understanding. So I took the opportunity when Professor Flurma, the old professor of psychology and philosophy at the University of Geneva, when he published a case of an American girl who had bestowed upon him a series of half poetic and romantic fantasies. He published that material without commenting on them. He gave it as an example of creative imagination. Now, when I read those fantasies, I saw this is exactly the material. I was always a bit afraid when I that people, when I tell of my personal experiences with patients, that they would say, oh, this is a merely suggestion, you know.
Yes.
I took that case because I surely had no hand in it. It was old Professor Flurma, an authority. He was a friend of William James. I knew him personally, a very fine old man, and he certainly wouldn't be accused of,
that's right,
of having influenced the patient.
Yes.
And that is the reason why I analyzed these fantasies, and that that case became the object of a whole book called The Psychology of the Unconscious. It is called now Symbolisms of Transformation.
Yes.
And I have revised it after 40 years. It needed it,
yeah,
because it was in the first attempt.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there I tried to show that there is a sort of unconscious, I then simply called it the unconscious, that clearly produces things which are historical and not personal.
Yes.
It was mythological material of the nature of which wasn't understood neither by Professor Flurma nor by the patient. And there I tried for the first time to produce a picture of the functioning of the unconscious, a functioning which allowed certain conclusions as to the nature of the unconscious. Then, after I had written that book, that cost me my friendship with Freud because he couldn't accept it.
Yes.
To him, the unconscious was a product of consciousness.
Yes.
And it simply contained the remnants. I mean, it was a sort of storeroom where all of the discarded things of consciousness were heaped up and left. And but to me, the unconscious then was already a matrix, a sort of basis of consciousness of a creative nature, namely capable of autonomous acts,
yes.
Autonomous intrusions into yes. consciousness.
Yes.
In other words, I took the existence of the unconscious for a real fact, or for a real autonomous factor capable of independent action.
Yes.
And now that was a problem, a psychological problem of the very first order. And that made me think, and furiously, because the role of philosophy nowadays has not yet recognized this fact, that we have a counteractor in our unconscious, that in our psyche there are two. Consciousness is one factor, and there is another factor, equally important, that is the unconscious, that can interfere with consciousness any time it pleases. And of course, I say to myself now, this is very uncomfortable, because I think I am the only master in my house, but I must have, admit that there is another somebody in that house that can play tricks. And I had to deal with the unfortunate victims of that interference every day in my patients. So the next thing I wrote was in 1918, namely a disquisition about the relations between the ego and the unconscious, where I tried to formulate the experiences that are more or less regularly observable in cases where consciousness is exposed to unconscious data, interferences or intrusions, where the unconscious is considered as an autonomous factor that has to be taken seriously, where one doesn't say anymore or undervalue the unconscious by assuming it is nothing but a discarded remnant of consciousness. It is a factor in its own dignity, and a very important factor, because it can create the most horrible disturbances. Now, when that was a pamphlet I wrote, it was published in French, and nobody understood it. I saw that the reason why nobody understands it is that while nobody has a similar experience, because the question hasn't been pursued to such an end, namely that one has taken the unconscious seriously and considered it as a real factor that can determine human behavior to a very considerable degree. So I began an examination of the human attitudes, namely how our consciousness functions. I couldn't help seeing, for instance, the difference between Freud and Adler. Typical difference. The one assumes that the things evolve along the line of the sex instinct. The other assumes that things evolve along the line of power drive. And there I was in between the two, but I could see the justification of Freud's view. I could also see the same for Adler. And I knew that there are plenty of other ways in which things could be envisaged. And so I consider my scientific duty to examine first the condition of the human consciousness that is the originator of ways of envisaging. It is the factor that produces attitudes, conscious attitudes towards certain phenomena. So when you know, for instance, that there are people who see the difference between red and green, you can take it for a fact that everybody sees that difference. Not at all. There are cases of Daltonism. And so on, you know. The one sees this, the other sees that. And I try to find out what the principal differences were. And that is the book about the types. And so first is introverted and extroverted attitude, then the functional aspects, namely which of the four functions is predominant. Now mind you, these four functions were not a scheme I had invented and applied to psychology. On the contrary, it took me quite a long time to discover that there is another type, but the thinking type. This, I thought, my type is of course that is human. It is not. There are other people who decide the same problems I have to decide in an entirely different way. They look at things in an entirely different way. They have entirely different values. They are, for instance, feeling types. And so, after a while, I discovered that there are intuitive types. They gave me much trouble. It took me over a year to become somewhat clear about the existence of intuitive types. And the last and the most unexpected was the sensation type. And only later on I saw that those are naturally the four aspects of conscious orientation. You can increase the number of principles, but I found the most simple way is the way I told you.
Yes.
As the division by four is a simple and actual division of a circle. I didn't know the symbolism of this particular classification. Only when I studied the archetypes, I became aware that this is a very important archetype.
Yes.
That has played an enormous role. I also found in the study of the types that it gives us a certain lead as to the personal nature of the unconscious, the personal quality of the unconscious in a given case. But to take an extrovert, well, his unconscious has then an introverted quality, because all the extroverted qualities are played in consciousness, and the introvert is left to the unconscious, therefore it has introverted qualities, and so on, with the functions the same.
Yes.
That gave me a lead of the diagnostic value. It helped me to understand my patients.
So, Professor Jung, so you began to see, in a sense, your typologies led to a sort of a theory of the psychology of opposites, that the conscious would reveal one side of a type and the unconscious would be the other side.
Yeah.
And that this would be a very important way then of helping you to analyze and understand the individual.
Diagnostically, it is quite, from a practical point of view, quite important. Well, the point I wanted to elucidate is, you know, in analyzing a patient, you make typical experiences. Namely, there is a sort of typical way in which the integration of consciousness takes place. Namely, the average way is that through the analysis of dreams, for instance, you become acquainted with the contents of the unconscious. I already told you this to begin with, all personal material. Subjective questions, questions of the individual's difficulties in adapting to environmental conditions, and so on.
Yes.
Now, it is a regular observation that when you talk to an individual and this individual gives you insight into its inner preoccupations, interests, emotions, in other words, hands over his personal complexes, then you get slowly and willy-willy into the situation of a sort of authority, a point of, you become a point of reference. You know you are in possession of all the important items in a person's development. I remember, for instance, I analyzed a very well-known American politician, and he told me, oh, any amount of the secrets of his trade. And suddenly he jumped up and said, by God, what have I done? You know, you get $1 million for what I have told you now. And I said, well, I'm not interested. You can sleep in peace, I shall not betray you. I forget it within a fortnight. Now, you see, that shows that the things people hand out are not merely indifferent things. When it comes to something important, emotionally important, then they hand out themselves. They hand out a big emotional value, as if they were handing over a large sum, as if they were trusting you with the administration of their estate.
Yes.
And they're tiring your hands.
Yes.
Often you need, you know, I hear things, well, that could ruin those people, utterly if they don't. Or it would give me, if I should have any blackmailing tendencies, unlimited power to blackmail them. Now, you see, that creates an emotional relationship to the analyst. And that is what Freud called the platform.
Yes.
Which is a central problem of analytic psychology. It is just so as if these people had handed out their whole existence, and that can have very peculiar effects upon the individual. Either they hate you for it or they love you for it,
yeah.
But you are not indifferent to them. And there is then a sort of emotional relation between the patient and the doctor.
Yes.
Now, you know, when you hand out such materials, then you, these contents are associated with all the important persons in the life of a patient. Now, the most important persons are usually father and mother.
Yeah.
That comes up from childhood. The first troubles are with the parents as a rule. So, in handing over your infantile memories about the father or about the mother, you hand over also the image of father and mother. Then it is just as if the doctor had taken the place of the father,
yes,
even of the mother. Yes. I had quite a number of male patients that called me Mother Jung, because they handed over the mother to me,
yes,
curiously enough.
Yes.
But you see, that's quite irrespective of the personality of the analyst. The sympathy is regarded. He functions as if he were the mother, or he functions as if he were the father, the central authority. And now that is what one calls transference. That's a particular case of projection.
Yes.
Now,
yes.
Freud doesn't exactly call it projection, he calls it transference.
Yes.
That is an allusion to the old and superstitious idea of handing over a disease,
yes,
transferring a disease upon an animal, or handing over the sin upon a scapegoat, and
yes,
the scapegoat takes it out into the desert and makes it disappear.
Yes, yes.
So they hand over themselves in the hope that I can swallow that stuff and digest it for them. And so I'm in loco parentis and have a high authority. Naturally, I'm also persecuted by the corresponding resistances, by all the manifold emotional reactions they have had against their parents. Now, that is the stuff you have to work through first in analyzing the situation, because a patient in such a condition is not free, he's the slave, he's utterly dependent upon the doctor, like a patient with an open abdomen on the operation table.
Yes.
He is in the hands of the surgeon, for better or worse. And so the thing must be finished, and so we have to work through that condition in the hope that we arrive in a situation where the patient is able to see that I'm not the father or not the mother, that I am an ordinary human being. Now, everybody naturally should assume that such a thing would be possible, for instance, that the patient could arrive at such an insight when he's not a complete idiot, that I am just a doctor and not that emotional figure of their fantasies. But that is very often not the case. So I had a case that was an intelligent young woman. She was a student of philosophy, very good mind, where one could expect easily that she would see that I am not the parental authority. But she was utterly unable to get out of this delusion. And in such a case, one always had recourse to the dreams. It is just as if one would ask the unconscious, now what do you say to such a condition? You see, she says, of course I know you are not my father, but I just feel like that, it is like that, I depend upon you. And I say, now you see what the unconscious says. Now the unconscious produced dreams in which I really assumed a very curious role. You know, she was a little infant, she was sitting on my knees, I held her in my arms, I was a very tender father to the little girl, you know, and more her dreams became emphatic in that respect, namely that I was a sort of child, and she is a very little, frail human thing, you know, and quite a little girl in the hands of an enormous being. And the last dream of that series was, I cannot tell you all the dreams,
yes,
was that I, it was out in nature, I stood in a field of wheat in an enormous field of wheat that was ripe for house. And I was a child. And I held her in my arm like a baby. And the wind was blowing over that field of wheat. Now, you know, when the wind is blowing over wheat fields, these waves in the wheat field.
Yes, yes.
And with these waves, I swayed like that, putting her as if it were to sleep, you know. And she felt as being in the arms of the Gore-Tex.
Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. And I thought, now the harvest is ripe.
Yes.
And I must tell her. And I told her, you see, what you want and what you project into me, because you are not conscious of it, is you have the idea of a deity. You don't possess. Therefore, you see it in me.
Yes.
That clicked.
Mm.
Because, you know, she had a rather intense religious education. Of course, it all vanished later on.
Yeah.
And something disappeared from her world. The world became merely personal. And that religious conception of the world was non-existent, apparently. But, you see, the idea of a deity is not an intellectual idea. It is an archetype. It's an archetypal idea. Therefore, you find it practically everywhere under this or another name. You know, even if it has the name Mana, it is an all-powerful, extraordinary effect or quality, even if it's not personal at all. And so she certainly became aware of an entirely heathenish image.
Yes.
That comes fresh from the archetype. She had not the idea of a Christian God or of an Old Testament Yahweh. It was a heathenish God, you see, a God of nature, of vegetation. He was the wheat himself, he was the spirit of the wheat, the spirit of the wind. And she was in the arms of that human. No. Now, that is the living experience of an archetype. Now, that made a tremendous impression upon that girl, and instantly it clicked. She saw what she really was missing, that missing value that was in the form of a projection in myself and made myself indispensable to her.
Yes.
And then she saw it is not indispensable, because it is, as the dream says, she is in the arms of that archetypal idea. Now that is a luminous experience, you see. And that is the thing that people are looking for.
Yes.
An archetypal experience that gives them an incorruptible value. You see, they depend upon other conditions, they depend upon their desires, their ambitions, depend upon other people, because they have no value in themselves. They have nothing in themselves. They are only rational. And they are not in the possession of a treasure that would make them independent. But when that girl can hold that experience, then she doesn't depend anymore. She cannot depend anymore, because that value is in herself. And that is a sort of liberation.
Yeah.
And that is, of course, makes her complete, you know. In as much as she can realize such a luminous experience, she is able to continue her path, her way, her individuation. The acorn can become an oak and not a donkey. Nature will take her course. She will become that which she is from the beginning. Now, having seen such cases, quite a number of such cases, that of course has given me a motive to study the archetypes, because I began to see that the structure of what I then call the collective unconscious is really a sort of agglomeration of such typical images, of which each has a numinous quality. You know, the archetypes are at the same time dynamic. They are instinctual images that are not intellectually invented. They are always there, and they produce certain processes in the unconscious. One could best compare with myths. That's the origin of mythology. Mythology is a pronouncing of series of images that formulate the life of archetypes. And so the statements of every religion and of many poets and so on are statements about the inner mythological process, which is a necessity, because man is not complete if he is not conscious of that aspect of things. So, you see, a man is not complete when he lives in a world of statistical truth. He must live in a world of his biological truth, that is his biological truth, that is not merely statistics. It is the expression of what he really is, as what he feels himself. So you see, somebody without the mythology is merely an effect of statistics, as it were. He's an average phenomenon. And while the truth is the carriers of life are individuals, not average numbers.
Yes.
Yet our natural science makes everything to an average, reduces everything to an average, and of course all the individual qualities are wiped out. That of course is most unbecoming. It is unhygienic. It deprives people of their specific values where they are individuals. It deprives them of the most important experiences of their life, where they experience their own value. Maybe the creative background of their personality. I see the trouble is that nobody understands these things, apparently. That's quite strange.
Do you think that the humanities are important for the individual who wants to study the individual?
One doesn't see what an education without humanities is doing to man.
Yes.
He loses the connection with his family, as it were. That means with the whole stem, the tribe, the connection with the past, that he lives in that in which man always has lived. Man has always lived in the myth. And we think we are able to be born today and to live in no myth, without history. That is a disease. That's absolutely abnormal, because man is not born every day. He's once born in a specific historical setting with the specific historical qualities, and therefore he's only complete when he has a relation to these things. It's just as if you were born without eyes and ears, when you are growing up with no connection with the past. From with the sample of natural science, you need no connection with the past. You can wipe it out.
Yes.
And that is a mutilation of the human being. Now I saw, from a practical experience, that this kind of proceeding had a most extraordinary therapeutic effect. I can tell you such a case. That was a young Jewish girl, and she, her father was a banker, and she had received an entirely worldly education. She had no idea of any tradition or so. And then I went further into her history and found out that her grandfather had been a tzaddik in Galicia, and when I knew that, I knew the whole story. That girl suffered from a phobia, a terrific phobia, and had been in a psychoanalytic treatment already with no effect. And she was really badly plagued by that phobia, anxiety states of all sorts. And then I saw that girl has lost the connection with the past, has lost, for instance, the fact that her grandfather was a tzaddik, that he lived in the myth, and her father has fallen out of it too. So I simply told her, you see, you will understand what your fear is. You know what you have lost? And she didn't, of course not. I said, your fear is the fear of your way.
Mm.
You know, the effect was that within a week she was cured from so many years of bad anxiety states. Because you see, that went like a lightning through her. But I only could say it because I knew that she is absolutely lost. She thought she was in the middle of things, but she was lost, gone. No, made no sense. What is our existence, you know, when we are just average numbers, you know? The more you make people to average numbers, the more you destroy our society.
Yes.
The ideal state is then a slave state. Then you can go to Russia. There is wonderful. There you can be a number, but. One pays it very dearly. Our whole life goes into blazes.
Okay.
And so he has plenty of cases of a similar kind. And that has naturally led me on to a profound study of the archetype. I got more respectful of archetypes. And now, by Jove, that thing should be taken into account. That is an enormous factor, very important for our further development and for our well-being. Now, in it was of course difficult to know where to begin because this is such an enormously extended field, and the next question I asked myself was, now where in the world has anybody been busy with that problem? And I found nobody, except a peculiar spiritual movement that went together with the beginnings of Christianity, namely the Gnostics. That was the first thing I said, and then I saw they were concerned with the problem of archetypes and made a peculiar philosophy of it. As everybody makes a peculiar philosophy of it when he comes across it naively and doesn't know that those are structural elements of the unconscious psyche. Now they have lived in the first, second, and third century, and what was in between? Nothing. And now today we suddenly fall into that hole and are confronted by the problems of the collective unconscious, which were then the same in 2,000 years ago, and we are not prepared to meet that problem. I was always looking for something in between, you know, something that linked that remote past with the present moment, and I found, to my amazement, it is alchemy. That is understood to be a history of chemistry. It is, one could almost say nothing less than that. It is a peculiar spiritual movement, or philosophical movement, they call themselves philosophers, like Gnosticism. And then I read the whole accessible literature, Latin and Greek, studied it because it was enormously interesting. It is the mental work of 1,700 years in which there is stored up all that he could make out about the nature of the archetypes in a peculiar way. That's true. It is not simple. And you know, most of the texts are not published, no more published since the Middle Ages. The last editions are in the middle or end of the 16th century, all in Latin, and some texts are in Greek, and not a few very important ones. Now, that has given me no end of work, but the result was most satisfactory, because it showed me the development of our unconscious relations to the collective unconscious, and the variations our consciousness has undergone while being unconsciously concerned with these mythological images. For instance, such phenomena as in Hitler or so, you know, that's our psychical phenomena, and we've got to understand these things. It's just as so as if a terrific epidemic of typhoid fever were breaking out, and we say, now this is typhoid fever, isn't that a marvelous disease? It can take on enormous dimensions, and nobody knows anything about it. Nobody takes care of the water supply. Nobody thinks of examining the meat or something like that. One simply states that this is a phenomenon, yes, but one doesn't understand it. And to me, of course, it was an enormous problem, because it is a factor that has determined the fate of millions of European people and of Americans. It is nobody can deny that he has been influenced by the war. But that is all Hitler's doing, and that's all psychology, our foolish psychology. But you only come to an understanding of these things when you understand the background.
Yes.
From which it springs.
Yes.
And so, of course, I cannot tell you in detail about about alchemy. It is the basis of our modern way of perceiving things, and therefore, it is as if it were right under the threshold of consciousness. Gives a wonderful picture of how the development of archetypes, that means the movement of archetypes looks, when you look upon them as a form of love, maybe from today you look back into the past and you see how the present moment has evolved out of the past. It is just as if the alchemistic philosophy, it sounds very curious, we should give it an entirely different name, it has a different name, it's called hermetic philosophy, of course that conveys just as little as the term alchemy.
Yes.
It is the parallel development, as Gnosticism was, to the conscious development, say, of Christianity, of how Christian philosophy, of the whole psychology of the Middle Ages. And so you see, in our days, we have such and such a view of the world, such and such a philosophy, but in the occultism we have a different one. And that we can see through the example of the alchemistic philosophy that behaves towards the medieval consciousness exactly like the unconscious behaves to ourselves. And we can construct or even predict our the unconscious of our days when we know what it has been yesterday. Now that is with a few words the development of my ideas. I think without going into detail, I couldn't further
elaborate. You have gone into great detail elsewhere, though, much of your writing, of course.
Well, people have to read the books finally, in spite of the fact that they are thick.
We're hoping that this will stimulate many of them to do a lot more reading. This is our big hope.
Well, now you could stop writing.
Well done, Matthew.